to smart.
Yes, we've got a packed show for you today. Just look out for the spectacular finale where I'll be showing you...
Indeed.
And I'll be in a special, very fabulous technique. Won't want to miss.
Fabulous. What a top, top, top show. Top show. Fabulous.
Fabulous? There's nothing fabulous about this at all. Look, you said you could fix this computer before Kirsten got back.
Oh, gotcha. Oh,
a sock? How did that get there?
Well, you see, it's a long story, but when I was down the Amazon, we came across this patch of Quick! She's coming!
What about the computer?
Don't worry. I've got a plan.
Hello. Now, unless those two have messed up my computer, I'm going to show you how to make this cuddly creature cover for your monitor. And I'm going to start with those huge googly eyes up the top there. Now, they are made with an old plastic cup or paper cup. And if you just cut about a centimetre off at the top, that'll make sure that your eyeball really sits in there nice and snug. But first of all, we need to cover this. Now, this is done with a strip of fur fabric. Put it fabric side down. And I've got a strip the same width as my cup. And all you do is wrap it around like so. And then with a stapler, just... one press and it's secured, or you could glue that, but keep your fingers well clear. And then you need one of these polystyrene balls, which you can get in DIY shops and craft shops, and just pop that inside. And all that needs now is a big black pupil on it, like this one here, because of course you need two eyeballs. And if you glue those together, they're then ready to go on top there on the frame. So the frame, you'll notice, doesn't go all the way around. I've kept these bits clear here where the buttons are, and the back, the ventilation area, which may get hot. There's nothing around there, but what I have done is measured my frame, and the edge is 6 centimetres long. So you need a box that's as wide as your frame, like this one here, and I've got the 6 centimetres that you can see here, and down the side to secure it so it's not going to fall off. And when you cut that out, you're left with this perfect frame, which is now ready to be covered with more of that fur fabric. So I've got about 1.5 metres worth of fur fabric, and if you fold it in half, find the centre point and mark it. That way you'll be sure you're not going to run out of material. And so just sit the frame on like so. And then all you have to do is fold the material over, bring back your stapler, and again, keeping your fingers clear, just staple on like that, press it well, or again you could glue this, but once you keep going all the way around and around and around, that will eventually all be covered beautifully like this one is here. Now this is now ready to have these hands attached that look like they're actually tapping away at your computer there. And all these are is again some more cardboard cut out in a hand shape this time, and again covered with more fur fabric, which all you do is slip them into the end of the material, and if you staple those down again, they're now ready. And then bring back your eyeballs. There they are. Stick them onto the top like that. And then you could personalise it like I've done here with these lovely pom-poms and pipe cleaners. And if you're into computer art, all you need to do is give it a bit of a mouse like that. Excellent. Hey, I take it all back. Mark's done quite a good repair job there. Hang on.
Are you okay?
No.
Well, I think she fell for it, though.
Oh. Ha, did she?
Here's a smart tip for you. I need to draw a circle. Now, most of you would use one of these, a compass. But what happens if you don't have one? Well, get yourself a piece of string, a drawing pin, and a pencil. Now, attach one end of the string to the pin and the other end to the pencil, and you've got your own compass. Look, I can work out how big I want to draw my circle, first of all, lightly with the pencil, and then when you work out where you want it, push down nice and hard, and there's your circle. Now, another trick, if you unwind the string a little bit, you can draw another curve. Unwind it again. There's another. One more time. You start to get a rainbow effect. Now look what happens if you wind it in a little bit more. And as you're drawing, you just keep your hand on it so it winds up the string. That's right. It draws a really nice spiral. And it's as easy as that. Go on, give it a go at home.
One of the most popular artists in American history is Norman Rockwell. He was well known for capturing the lives of ordinary Americans during the 20th century. For example, the increase in the production of cars after World War II led to more families exploring their own country, taking day trips and vacations. His painting, Going and Coming, shows a typical post-war family off on such a trip and then returning. In contrast, the excitement of the whole family at the start of the day with the sheer exhaustion on their faces when they return. Where have they been? What have they been up to? Rockwell's paintings were often comical and inquisitive, which is probably why people love to explore them over and over again. Mum, are we nearly there yet?
Today I'm visiting a typical English garden. And a typical Japanese garden. And a very thick, dense rainforest. And a very dry desert. I'm in Kew, West London, home of the Royal Botanic Gardens. The purpose of this place is to collect as many of the world's plants to study and conserve them. And it's also open to the public. So, how do they manage to find the right environment for so many different plants? Well, the answer for some is to build a giant greenhouse. The palm house was built between 1844 and 1848 to house exotic palms and tropical plants. So how can I paint a building as intricate as that without spending hours over it? Well, here's the smart way. Now, for my picture, I'm not going to use any of the paper in this pad. In fact, I'm going to be using the cardboard that's on the back of it. And for the painting, I'm not going to use any old paintbrush. I'm going to use this. Cardboard. Now, the first things I'm going to do is get some paint. Let's give it a nice splodge of blue and see what it looks like when I scrape it across the card. Wow, look at that. Now, what happens if I mix some more paint with it? With a different colour on it. Let's put some splodges up there, just a little bit at first. Look at that. Now, it may not be that sunny today, but I'm going to do the sky blue anyway. I really like that already. Now, I'm going to work on some of the greens. You can be as sloppy as this as you like. Just really mix it on the card itself. Look at that. Now, we're going to work on the hedges and some of the darker trees. We're going to use some dark greens. Now over there I can see some trees that are behind the glass house, so they kind of come up there. Let's just squiggle that on. And just to get splodging. Now that's where the rose beds go over there, and there's some hedges. Now, for the glasshouse, I'm using two sorts of white acrylic paint and iridescent white paint. Iridescent means it's got a slightly shininess to it, which should look really good for the glass. Let's get it all splodged on in the middle. Now, there's a sort of a grooved texture to the glasshouse, which is, in fact, all the small panes of glass being joined together. And for that, I've cut a zigzag here with a pair of pinking scissors. But if you haven't got those, you can use a normal pair of scissors and just cut grooves in. And when I rub this over the paint, look what happens. So it took 4 years to build the palm house, 40 minutes to paint the palm house. I wonder how long it takes to clean the windows.
Gilmore wants to know, how do you draw a snake on a branch? Well, I've got my branch here in pencil, that's quite important. And now, with a pencil again, I'm just going to do a wiggly line on that branch. And then with a nice thick pen, I'm just going to follow that line. So I'm going to start here with the tail and then go over the branch there, like that. Then this time, go behind the branch, so miss that bit and start again here at the top of the branch, like that. And then go over it again here, like that, and go behind it here. So we'll go behind that branch and this branch and reappear here with a nice head on my snake, a bit of an eye and a tongue, and then really bring it to life with a bit of a pattern like that. This is just a zigzaggy pattern following where I've drawn my lines all the way, like that. Doesn't have to be neat at all. And the final touch is just to rub out those pencil lines that you can see on the branch. And there you have it, there's your snake on the branch. Why don't you give it a whirl at home?
Time to take a look at the bigger picture now in the gallery.
James Gurlis has used an interesting reverse applique technique to create this abstract fabric picture.
Rachenet's created a very colourful watercolour landscape.
Cameron's cleverly added something to his paint to create a wonderfully textured picture.
If you want to see your work in the gallery, then look out for the address at the end of the show.
Whilst the setup for the next thing in the studio, I've come into makeup to show you this.
Yep, that's 4 sugar cubes.
It's 500. It's got to be a record.
Can you two just clear off for a second?
Oh, got you. Sorry.
Thank you. Right, where was I? Oh, yes, this. Your very own placemat for mealtimes. What you need to start off with is some nice bright coloured card that's big enough to hold your plate and your knife and fork. And then you need to draw around your plate with a different piece of coloured card, so that will make your plate, with some sticky tape on it so that you can stick it down into position. I've started putting some food on already. Got some beans, got some bacon. It's all just different coloured bits of card again. If I put the yellow circle in there, you can see it's an egg. And look at these for 2 brilliant bangers. Just play around with where you want everything, and then you can secure it by gluing it down when you're ready, or with double-sided tape. And the final thing to add is a fork and a knife, and then you're ready to cover it in sticky back plastic to give it this brilliant laminate effect and also make it wipe clean for mealtimes. And the hardest part's going to be deciding what your favourite meal is. I mean, look at this, fish and chip supper complete with paint ketchup.
Kirsten! Kirsten!
What?
We're waiting for you.
Ha! You're waiting for me?
Yes, we're waiting for you. We haven't got all day. Oh,
what's happened here? Goodness me, what's gone on with the... How did that get there?
How to draw an avalanche.
An avalanche? OK, Maya, I'll show you. Get a bit of chalk here, do some... a selection of little mountain ranges there, just them. In blue, there's a bit of white there, snow-capped. Lovely. Now your avalanche is creeping down here, a bit like a river snaking its way down. And if you look, as it gets towards you, it's getting bigger and bigger and more frantic. And all you have to do there, if you smudge it with your fingers, you get that real feeling that it's bouldering down the hill. Now just top that off, chuck in a bit of blue just to get a bit of detail, a bit of light and dark. And there, Maya, is your rather nasty, torrid avalanche.
What do you think of that?
Thanks, that's great.
Came. They brought an intelligent elephant and Nelly was her name. One dark night, she slipped her iron chain and off she ran to Hindustan and was never seen again.
Nelly the elephant popped her trunk and said goodbye to the circus. Off she ran with a trumpety trump, 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 trump.
Thank you.
OK, Spayers, you keep a lookout. Sweet one, Kirsten. Right, everyone, have a pat butchers at this 34-carat selection of potpourri. All essential items for your next smart. But remember, you saw it here first. All right, now get on the end of this. Some sponge foam, pom-poms, pipe cleaners, and lucky bands. And they're all yours if you can go out and find them.
Here, J-Boy, who am I on the meet-up lookout for?
Oh, you Muppet. Come on, quick, clear it.
Yeah. And remember, he who draws wins.
You know, it's funny that electrical storm seems to have sorted out my computer. Oh, do you know anything about this, by the way?
Oh, Mark will be pleased. He's got a pair now. Hang on, that's a different pattern from the one he found in your computer.
Right, where is he?
Guys, hello. I don't know how this happened, but...
We'll see you next time.
Bye.
Oi, here, have your sock back.
Oh, thanks. Can I come out now?
If you want to send a picture into the gallery, this is the address. Smart, P.O. Box 5053, London W12 6AW. If you want a fact sheet, please send a large stamped addressed envelope to the same address. You can also get a fact sheet via the CBBC website.
While unwinding the show, I've got time to show you this, my very own feather bird. All you need is a bit of string, some modelling clay on the end of it, and stick in some feathers. Let's put one at the back. Let's use some of these nice colourful ones I got from a party shop. But you can find feathers everywhere. Often find them in my bed, coming out of the pillow. Let's put that in. And all you need now is a head. So let's use another bit of clay and attach a little kind of triangular piece on it for a beak. Give it two eyes, easy, and then put it straight onto the body. There you go, you've made your very own feather bird. Go on, give it a go. I must fly.